Okay, VR peoples, we're going to do a video now that is all about lighting, and I think it's long overdue, because I know that when you're coming from ArcViz, understanding Unreal Engine can be difficult, especially if you're just used to 3ds Max and an offline renderer like V-Ray. And one of the biggest things that you have to overcome is completely revamping your mindset when it comes to lighting, because the lighting works totally different in real time than it does in offline renderers. So I want to go over some of the theory of lighting in Unreal Engine. I want to go through some of the techniques, the different kinds of lights, and how to wrap your head around light baking and understand what exactly is going on and how to make it look good. Okay, so stay tuned for all of that. What I've done so far is just make a basic scene. It's just a box. I'm in the first-person shooter template. It's got a sphere inside of it. I used some of the new substance materials and applied it. There's a basic direct light out here and a skylight. Okay, fantastic. Everything is pretty straightforward so far. We do have a light mass importance volume. You may know that the direct light that comes standard in the template is set to stationary. So let's first talk about the differences between stationary, static, and movable lights. If you hover over them, they'll tell you what they are. Static is fully baked lighting, fastest rendering, obviously. It's baked into the scene. So when you do your build and you build your lighting, it is actually baking it onto this and none of it is being computed in real time. Stationary is a hybrid. It can't move, but it allows partially baked lighting and dynamic shadows from movable objects. Okay, so keep that in mind. It's a bit of a hybrid. And then there's the movable light, which can actually be totally dynamic and move throughout your scene in real time. Whole scene dynamic shadows. Slowest rendering, obviously, and it does not contribute to the light bake. Okay? So what is the light bake? The light bake is where you can think of it as your global illumination. Okay, if I put a light out here that is, say this was static, it would calculate all the highlights. It would even bounce lighting, calculate where the shadows will be, where the highlights will be, and then it will map it onto these objects. That is what light baking does. So there is global illumination going on, but it's not happening in real time. We're baking it in. So when would you use these different kinds of lights? Well, let's test them all out. First, I'm going to set the sun to be static. Okay. And then we're just going to do a basic light build. We'll go to lighting quality preview and just build the lighting. What this is going to do is bake in all the global illumination and the direct lighting from that static sun coming through my little skylight up here and lighting my scene. So we'll see what kind of results we get. All right, there we go. So you can see the direct light coming in. And you can see that global illumination is happening because the rest of my scene is also lit up. I've got a cool reflection on this tile right here. That's awesome. You can also see some shadowing going on underneath of the ball. It's not very high quality, but that's because of settings. It's also because my build lighting quality was on preview. So there's lots of different things that go into that. That is for another time right now. But there you go. There's the baked lighting. You can also see that in the corners, there's some ambient occlusion going off. And that's kind of tricking our eyes a little bit, showing lighting that isn't actually there, isn't being calculated by the light bake. So let's just turn that off for now. Go into project settings, ambient occlusion. Let's just turn it off entirely. Okay, there you go. So there's our light bake without any ambient occlusion. And you can see that works pretty well. Actually, I'm going to turn off one other thing too, the auto exposure. And what this does, I mean, we can obviously turn these back on later. We can also do them through our post-processing volume. But right now I'm turning them off so that we are getting rid of all the different variables that can be going on here. Okay, so you can see it's considerably darker here. There is a little bit of light in here, but it's not very bright. Let's actually turn up the sun, like 15. One thing to keep in mind is this skylight up here. You can actually apply an HDRI map to it right here and light your scene with an HDRI. So that's cool. Of course, that's probably something you're used to, right? Let's turn up the intensity of that too. Let's bake it again, get some more light in here. Okay, now it's brighter. Boom, we got the scene lit up a little bit in here. So without the exposure settings, it's still working. You can see there's a little bit of shadow coming off this way. That's because there's a bright highlight right there casting a shadow. So you can see there's global illumination going on. Now, the global illumination is not very high quality. That would be adjusted in your world settings here under light mass. And it's basically these five settings right here. Okay. The most basic way to adjust this would be to up the number of indirect lighting bounces. Okay, that will make it higher quality. You can put it at 10. You can put the skylight bounces to something higher as well, perhaps even 10. And then the indirect lighting quality, you could put up to 6. This is very high settings, and you can even adjust these downward below 1, this one and this one, to make even higher settings, but that will up your build times dramatically. So this could be considered sort of like your secondary bounce render settings, your GI render settings, like if you were using V-Ray. Okay, they don't translate directly, but that's kind of the kind of quality that they're controlling. Okay, so look up the documentation on this, and you'll see that going like 100 bounces gives you very little difference from 10 bounces, but the difference between 10 bounces and 1 bounce is very dramatic. Okay, so you don't necessarily want to just crank this and crank this higher and higher. But this number, the indirect lighting quality, will actually give you considerable amount more quality. It also makes your build times go nuts. So let's do this. Well, actually, for now, let's just put this down pretty low. Okay, and we'll leave this at 1.5 because I'm just demonstrating here. But the numbers I had before could be used to get much higher quality stuff. But I don't want to wait for all these build times while I'm just trying to demonstrate. Okay, so that's that. Let's build that one more time to look and see what it looks like. And here, preview, medium, high production. This is going to be also contribute to how accurately it's calculating everything. So you can see a choppy edge on this shadow up here. If you put this lighting quality to high or medium, then you might start seeing that go away. I'll put it on medium and build. Okay, that didn't take too long at all. You can see this shadow's looking nicer now, obviously. The corners are getting a little bit darker because the GI knows that not as much light is getting into those corners. Anyway, overall, our calculation is getting better. You can see that this is a nice soft shadow being cast here onto that wall, a little sharper up on the top. So that's all in our quality settings. Okay, so that's that. I talk about that elsewhere in other videos. Okay, but I want to talk more about this stationary light we've got up here. The static light. Okay, that is static, so everything's being baked in. What if this was an object that we were going to pick up in VR and move around? What would we do then? Well, we change it to a movable object, and then we go down and say, in the lighting. Okay, if this is a movable object, then we don't want it being baking shadows onto the ground, because then when we pick it up, there'll be a big black spot there that we don't want. Let's just do that as an example. Actually, it's already done. It's baked in. If we moved it, then that shadow would just remain there. Okay, we don't actually want that. So what we do, if that's going to be a movable object, we would make sure that in the cast shadow settings, it doesn't cast a static shadow, but it does cast a dynamic shadow. Okay. Now we could change this to a stationary light, which of course will bake some of the lighting, but it will also cast dynamic shadows. Okay, so let's build that and see what it looks like. Okay, you can see that the static lighting is not working on this anymore. It's no longer casting any shadow down here, and it's not getting darker as it goes around this curve or anything like that. It looks kind of dramatically different, but it is something that you can pick up. And notice what happens when you move the ball around, and especially if you moved it over to here into the shadow. Voila, look at that. So that looks realistic when you pick it up and move it around. That's actually really cool. So the stationary light would be awesome in your scene if this is the kind of thing you want to do. If there's going to be a movable object moving through that direct light, that's why the sun by default is set to stationary light, so that it can do these kind of things. So if you have movable objects, the lighting still works. Okay, so that's pretty cool, actually. That looks really good. However, if you're in your scene and you want the sun to move, it would not work. That is not a movable light, it is only stationary. And the other thing to remember about stationary lights is you can only have so many of them. What's the number? 6 or is it 4? I don't remember. But you can only have so many of them overlapping with each other. If I took now a spotlight and put it into the scene here, made it stationary, right? And then I made some more stationary lights. Now we're at 1, 2, 3 plus the sun, 4 overlapping. The fifth one gives me a red X. Okay, so that's because these cone shapes are overlapping with each other. You can't have more than 4 of those cones on stationary lights overlapping with each other. Okay, so you have to keep that in mind. You can address that by making the cones smaller and then making the lights further apart. Or you can also change the attenuation radius so that it doesn't influence as far away. But as long as these cones are intersecting with each other, that counts as one light. And you can only have 4 of them that are stationary and overlapping like that. Okay, so that's another thing to keep in mind. With movable, you'll have similar problems, and this will also potentially slow down your real-time rendering dramatically if you have a bunch of fully dynamic lights. But if you wanted to animate the sun, then that's what you would need. You need a movable light. Or if you want a light that turns on and off and those kind of things, completely dynamic, right? And it creates dynamic shadows. It does not figure into the big lighting at all. So that is the difference with that. So for ArcViz, I think we'll probably be using most of the time static or stationary lights, but we might also want to use movable, especially if we have interaction going on with those lights. Okay, so this one we'll probably leave as stationary as well. We'll bake it one more time. Okay, there you go, all baked. This thing doesn't leave a big dark shadow there because that light is stationary, and the shadow remains dynamic. And then when we come over here, we've got a dynamic shadow as well, which is pretty cool looking, actually. Okay, so that is the difference between a static, fully baked light and stationary lights / movable lights with dynamic shadows, okay? Let's change this all back to static for one last test. That one's static, and that guy's static, and this guy light is static. We'll do one last test here. We'll build it one more time, see what we get. Oh, we forgot to do one thing. So everything's baked, but this thing is not casting a static shadow. So really, it doesn't look right at all. Make sure to turn that static shadow back on right there. Try that one more time. Dang, you got to also make it static object. Try one more time. Okay, so here you go. This is all baked lighting, right? So if I move this, it's going to look wrong right away. Totally wrong. And immediately it says lighting needs to be rebuilt because you can't move static objects, okay? That shadow will remain there. Everything will look incorrect. Okay, so when we're doing ArcViz, this might actually be the way that we want to use it most of the time. If it's just a scene that we're going to walk through and nothing's going to be moving around and we're not going to be interacting with things, everything can be static, including the lights. But if we're getting into VR and we're going to walk over here and pick this thing up, or if there's anything dynamic going on, like, okay, I want to switch this ball out for a different ball or for a different material, or I want to move this ball over here, then you have to start thinking about what kind of lights you're going to want to use, what kind of shadows you're going to be wanting to use. Okay, so like I said, if you're seeing static, you can do everything static. You can bake crazy complicated lighting schemes. Just bake it in, and then nothing's calculated in real time, and everything will run smoothly. Okay, so hopefully that helps demystify some of the lighting techniques going on in here, helping you understand the difference between baked versus dynamic lighting, and how to get the effects that we want. Now, the only other thing I want to look at is some of these optimization view modes. Right now, we're in lit. If we go to detail lighting, it'll show us just the lighting. And you can see this here, see this shadow here, how choppy it is and how choppy this shadow is. Some of that can be addressed by doing a higher quality light build, but really a lot of that is dependent on another view mode here, which is the light map density, optimization view mode, light map density. You can see that this is how dense our light maps are. And of course, the light map is like a shadow map in 3ds Max maybe, but it's basically a map that tells where the highlights and shadows are on each face of each object individually. That's why we do the UVW unwrapping. So let's look at this static mesh by double clicking on it. Let's look at the UVs. Okay, that's not the right channel. This is going to be our channel. It was automatically created on import when I used Datasmith to import. You can also automatically create that when the FBX import. But you notice each face needs its own unique space to have that light map applied to. And then you have to make sure that this UV channel is the one that's accepting the light map, and then you make sure that lighting resolution, that light map resolution, is high enough. So light map coordinate index is set to 2, which is the right one. It looks great. Everything's separated. We could up this to 1024 and save it. And then when we're back in our mode, now we're getting a really high resolution on that thing. Red means high resolution. And you can look and see how big these squares are to know how much resolution there is. And that should be sufficient. Okay, so that's a big way. Let's look back at our lighting. Okay, everything's going to have to be rebuilt now because we've changed the light mass settings, the light map settings. And they should be higher quality now. And let's go with a high quality build. Build the lighting again. We've got our light maps at the right resolution. And let's see what we get here. It should be a pretty good result. The only other thing we would do after this is go back to those world settings I would show you and up those settings really high, which that will be our last final test, I promise. Okay, so this looks pretty awesome. I'm getting some clean results down here. We could probably go even higher with the settings for this particular shadow here. Higher light mass setting, or higher light map settings, and then a higher quality build. We are getting some nice sharpness up here in this shadow, and then softness as it comes down. Overall, this lighting's looking pretty great. You can see that without ambient occlusion turned on at all, you're still getting dark corners and things like that. So the global illumination is working quite well. So the last test we'll do, the last and final test in this video, is just to up our settings. So I'll just go with something that I've found to work basically well. And I'm not going to claim that this is the best settings for this all around. But these have worked pretty well for me. Now, the time in the build is going to go way up. So I'll pause it, and I'll build it, and I'll show you the results. Okay, here we go. I cranked the settings up. I even went to lighting quality production level. Okay, I exaggerated a little bit on how long it was going to make my render times because this is a simple scene, so it still built the light really quick, but on a big scene with a ton of lights and lots of light map resolution going on, it can take a really long time. So keep that in mind, but this is the kind of quality of lighting we can get, and this is still a little choppy down here. The best way to address that would be to turn up the light map resolution, do something ridiculously high on this object here, and that would eventually take care of that. Okay, so you can see that the global illumination is actually pretty high quality right now. Look at this corner up here. You can see that the bouncing of the light is going quite well. There's a nice crisp shadow right there that gets softer and softer as it comes down the wall. Everything is quite realistic, actually. Okay, as you can see, the lighting looks pretty dang good here. Everything is nice. Everything, the light bounce is going very well. So that's the kind of results you can get. If you can get away with making everything static, you can actually get very photorealistic lighting going on inside Unreal Engine 4. And if you need things to be movable, then you isolate those objects with the proper lights that they need and the proper type of shadows. They will not look as realistic if they are interactive and they cannot do these nice static shadows. But they will remain fairly accurate and at least represent shadows properly onto your scene. So hopefully that helps you guys out transitioning from V-Ray or Corona or some other offline rendering program into real-time rendering with Unreal Engine 4.